very quickly, for those of you who know, the TIC programme is at the end of its first year. It was a programme which is collaboratively led by Joint Improvement Team, Scottish Government, Scottish Centre for Telehealth and e-health programmes. We've now got a new director within a division within Scottish Government which is dedicated to technology enabled care. And those of you who knew Margaret Wariski, who was former Jit, is the director of that division. Looking forward, strategic and national delivery plan, we can't express how important technology and digital care is for the future of health, social care, and the population of Scotland. Its contribution to enhancing outcomes for people of Scotland, addressing inequalities, and supporting efficiency and economy can't be understated. We've had £30 million, £10 million over 3 years, although spending review has seen a 10% chop out of that this coming year, to deliver the Technology Enabled Care programme. It sets its foundations in the National Telehealth and Telecare Delivery Plan from 2012. So, really delivering the tech programmes, focusing on these aims. So, outcomes, embedding it in strategic planning and core redesign processes, getting technology into create sustainable and cost-effective services, making it a norm. I think we heard yesterday, I know Sally was at an event in
Campus Line,
Glasgow, where we had a feedback from all the partnerships involved in the programme, and one of the most consistent things was tech shouldn't be just a programme, it's not just an add-on, tech should be the norm, it should be sustained in practice, it should be core business, it should be what we do. And I think trying to transform our programme into core business is quite a challenge, but that is the aim there. And it's also about multi-agency across agencies, housing, health, social care, third sector, and the general public. There's far more going on in the digital landscape out with our statutory services than there is within them. That's probably the best place to innovate and create. We need to know what we're doing, trying to measure what we're doing, is that having an impact on outcomes and how are we progressing. There's five core work streams under the tech programme, with improvement programme cutting right through the middle. We'll just say a little bit about each of those. Expansion of home health monitoring. Is everyone aware what home and mobile health monitoring? So people who can manage their long-term conditions or measure their own their blood pressure at home. It's most commonly used with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or heart failure. Diabetes is a big growing field. People just monitoring the symptoms, that may be doing it with a saturation monitor that they pop on their finger, it tells them how their blood oxygen levels are, or it might be with a sphygmomanometer, taking their own blood pressure, texting results back to a central digital base that communicates with their GP. It could be about smoking cessation, it could be about mental health, or the world of home and mobile health improvement devices is growing. In terms of where we are nationally though, it's a slowly evolving world. We've probably had about 500 additional people through home and health, mobile health monitoring in the last year through the programme. So in comparison to telecare, your community alarms, the technology around that, it is an evolving field. Lots going on and a great way to go. Really important in terms of trying to keep people safe and well, so prevent escalation of health conditions, avoiding admission, helping to get people home, and just generally keeping people well and in control of their own health. Expansion of the National VC, and I've got Cathy Dorian in the audience, and myself being here as an expert in the field, but trying to roll out the use of VC, so on a national coordinated kind of programme to help reach into rural areas to assist with making connections between people in their homes, people in clinics, in leisure centres, to nursing homes, and in particular there's some good work being done in our nursing home community. Kathy was involved in leading a bit of work with a care home in Ballaghulish, where the population in a care home, particularly with dementia, had to travel 2 hours, 80 miles to see a consultant, rare visits from CPNs, not a great connection for in terms of health service. And they now run twice weekly clinics with the psychiatry service in Inverness. Yes?
What's VC?
Video conferencing, sorry. Oh. Yeah. Please do stop me, I'm on a tight run around and I appreciate we've got a mixed audience. So video conferencing, the ability to speak through a tablet, speak through a TV, a monitor, or a video, specific video conferencing kit. So now patients and the paid care staff and the care home evaluators can have a communication, a quality conversation, consultation with medical nursing staff, and that's extended beyond that, Cathy, hasn't it?
Yeah, we've input now from wound management, Highland Hospice Care as well, and pharmacy, polypharmacy reviews, medication reviews, and lots of staff in the area now come in and use it too. So instead of travelling to and from meetings, now they can come into the care home and use the equipment. A lot of carers come in to sit in on the consultations too, so families are involved as well in linking up to the dementia specialist up in Inverness, so it's going really, really well. And from there we've rolled out another two care homes in Highland, so one in Fort William and the other one in Malaig. So again, very remote and rural, but you can be remote and rural within an urban setting too, because if you're in a care home and you need access to specialist staff, it's very difficult to transfer patients backwards and forwards and ambulances, etc. It takes away staff from the care home. So we see this technology being incredibly useful across that care home setting, regardless of their geography.
Yeah, and again, yesterday we had an ambulance service manager who said, at this point in time, there will be many, many frail people in an ambulance right now being taken from a remote village on the periphery of a health board or a partnership area, be brought to the hospital where sometimes it's a 2 hour wait to have a 5 minute consultation to say come back in 3 months. Could we not have a national infrastructure where you might pop into a local community centre or a GP practice, or where the communication with your health, social care, broader community, more distant community can be brought to you. Both saving a lot of travel, pain, and funding as well. So a lot of time spent travelling to appointments that are not necessary. The appointment is necessary, but the travel may not be. Extending digital platforms. You've seen lots downstairs, and again, this is a world that is exploding. In terms of national investment, there's lots of pockets of activity, but work such as supporting Living It Up, which is a national platform that's been rolled out partnership at the moment, but is an evolving platform built with communities to try and serve the needs of the people using it. So access to what's going on in your community, health advice. This is Smart Care, is the links to a European project that's about falls or prevention of falls. So personal planning, personal tips, hints, how do I assess my risk of falling? How can I do that myself or with a family member or with some support? So Living It Up is evolving. Alice as well, national online platforms for sharing information. But lots of work going on. It's not my specialist area, the digital world, but we all use it. We all use our mobile phones, we all use apps, we all connect in different ways to improve our lives. An opportunity for everyone. Telecare is probably the longest standing, most embedded technology based care that we have, and most people would know someone with a community alarm, pendant or bell cords, and or both in house. There's now an exploding amount of technology that can help support people in home, from falls monitors, bed monitors, door alerts, technology that can help people with dementia, can keep carers, families' minds at ease. I've got a little video at the end which should quite simply demonstrate something, the impact that, that telecare can have on individuals and their family. So there's a real push, is about 5,000 extra people supported through telecare. That's technology in their own home, keeping them safe, keeping them enabled, keeping them connected in the last year. And with a particular focus on supporting people with dementia, for prevention. This is an example. The technologies that can be appropriate to individuals, from smoke sensors, everyone should have a smoke detector in their house, but not everyone does. Fire services are supportive and engaged in the telecare programme. Carbon monoxide flood sensors, what happens when the alert will be triggered back to an alarm receiving centre. In some areas will have a responder service and they will respond if necessary, and others will have a family alert or personal contact. In Edinburgh, there's 8,500 service users. They have 263 alarm calls last year. 263,000, yes. Of which around 9,000 required an emergency visit from their responder. So first off, if the responder service hadn't gone out, would that have been an ambulance call? Would it have been somebody left just until somebody came along? And of that, only of the 5,000 fallers, 2% were admitted. So trying to be proactive, the right response at the right time for people. So having technology can open doors and keep people safe in their own home, where otherwise people might be frightened, they might not feel safe, their family may not feel that they're able to stay at home, but technology can help. It's not a replacement for people, and that's by no means.
So I'm just going to say that the manager in charge of the service, she actually attends the discharge planning meetings at the local hospital.
That's right.
So therefore she can triage patients who are waiting to go home onto this particular service, so that it's very linked up and very integrated. It's a really good example of how this work, you know, serves Edinburgh really, really well.
And other challenges are, is how do you get technology enabled care embedded into assessment early enough? So whether it's for home health monitoring, whether it's for simple access to well-being advice or digital platforms, when you see your GP, when you're admitted to hospital, when you have a crisis, how do we make sure that people are getting the opportunity to know about technology, have access to it much sooner in the process? This, I'll flick over that. Ultimately, in the world ahead of us, BT will probably switch off their analog service. I think it was Sweden, they just decided that they were. We no longer have analog services, so digital is the way forward, and that means all of our telecare systems that are analog, they're all through the telephone wires, and we need to think about moving to more digital mobile solutions. Not easy when you really don't have a mobile signal, but that is, it's on the cards, it's on the plan, and we're looking to test one or two areas next year, trying to get a digital end-to-end, so that, again, my technical expertise is that means that your call centre would be digitally enabled, and your technology would be digitally enabled, and they would speak to each other through SIM cards or through your Wi-Fi in your home, to sort of cuts out the single line, and that explodes a whole lot of opportunities for linking up information. So still a long way off the line, but we will be testing our digital telecare one. New things for those of you, some of that might be familiar, some of you are care professionals. There's a technology charter that was launched in December for technology and living with dementia. That's worth a look, Alzheimer's Scotland website. That actually the rights enabling people with dementia to benefit from technology. And the main thing, people who are older can't access computers, that's not going to work. There's a wealth of opportunity, learning and benefits that can be gained. So that's worth a look. Deloitte report published last year. As we're pushing digital technology and it's advancing, it's becoming cheaper, so it's becoming more mainstream. It has the potential to improve health outcomes, no doubt about it. It empowers people, it gives people a sense of control, safety and enablement. And it's a key support for carers. But it's slow. It is a slow process. It is by no means charging your head at the rate of Steve Jobs' Apple, iPhone. I think that's slowing down a little bit as well. So Google is the future, I believe. But it's slow, but it's steady. For those professionals amongst you, we have a knowledge hub, a place for sharing, third sector, independent sector, a place for sharing knowledge and trying to spread good news and good examples. The knowledge hub there. And actually, at the bottom of it, it's about bringing technology and human behaviour together. It is not about replacing care or people with technology. It's about what is the optimisation of that whole thing.
We don't want to add the tail again for another ad. Something really, it was just.
You'll hear that.
That's a journey, worrying constantly. We couldn't go, you know, because Jimmy didn't want to go, he just wanted to stay in the flat. But if I went out, there was worry about what Jimmy would do while I was out, because he would put like the electric kettle onto the cooker, set it on fire. He went missing on Christmas Eve along the shore. Everywhere we went, everywhere, hours, we had to get the police and everything. And finally he arrived home. We don't know where he was or what he did, but I just was in tears. Christmas was there because that worry was, it was freezing and he was wondering about when we went to bed, I didn't get any sleep. Because the minute Jimmy moved or was up, he was in, like turning the cooker and trying to light us cigarettes, bits of paper, anything. So I got up with Jimmy, made him a cup of tea, and when he decided he was tired, we'd go back to bed. But then maybe for a couple of hours, he'd get up another time, he'd try and put an egg on the cooker, put the cooker on, nothing on the cooker, just the egg. This is all the things you were, you know, getting up and seeing. It was just terrible. What do you do? Is it coming to now that I need to stay in the house constantly, day and night, and not have a life? Or do you put him in a home, which I love him and I don't want to do that? He's a lovely man, he's strong, he's healthy, and he can't help having dementia. And what about us, the carers? We need people to come along and help us. And that's what happened. Jimmy had a couple of strokes, and I phoned up the social work and they told me that I could have the alarm to put his medication in so that if I wasn't here, if I was at work, he knew when to take his tablets, because it buzzes and buzzes and you take your tablets. They also gave me an alarm if Jimmy too ill at any time. I could just press a button and that put me directly through to the hospital. The difference the alarm made was a bit of help that if Jimmy took ill or anything like that, you know, but it wasn't helping me with dementia, which was that's a separate illness. I mean, if you take a stroke, a heart, you can get treated for that, you know, but it's a different treatment for dementia. You need somebody to come in and put stuff in that you know the person is going to be safe in the home. I get told about Isabel at the social work department. Isabel came to the home to talk to us and see Jimmy. She was very concerned when I told her everything that had happened. She had a look about the house and she thought, you need a lot more with the way Jimmy is. She spoke to Jimmy and she realised that. So Isabel got to work quick and she got everybody in, looking about what to do. They got us, they covered the switch in the cooker, which was fabulous. So Jimmy can't put the cooker on now and can't do anything after the key. She got me an alarm at the door. This is all wired up. So if I say to Jimmy, which I couldn't do before, I'm going to the shop for a wee while for him going there about. You're right, I switch it on here. There's a switch. And that alerts that if Jimmy gets out, but when Jimmy comes to this door, which he does often, I don't think that he hears this. Every time he shuts the door, it's my voice, which just makes him feel safe.
Another good thing that I got was a buddy, which is fabulous because he has that on him all the time. And even if he's on his bus going to his wee club, they'll phone and say, he's out of the town, and I'll say, I know, where is he such? He's on the bus, it's all right. But they've came to me, and I know they're looking after Jimmy for me. They know where he is, and they're telling me. The other thing is the heat detector in the kitchen, because I always had to worry, well, what if, you know, the oven's on and it heats up. Although he can't get in it now, but there's a heat detector there that if there is anything, that helps, the alarm goes off. There's a smoke detector in the hall that if anything happens, I've got the protection of that. You know, everything's there, everything to help me. And it's made me so happy. I've got a life. I can say to Jimmy, right, I'm going to Marks and Spencer's, I'm going to the shops, I'll be an hour. I know that if he's got all this stuff looking after him, and he's quite happy. Because I said, do you want to come with me? No, I'll stay here. It's two people's lives that's affected. It's not just the person with dementia. It's the person that's caring for the person. And the only people that care is these people that came and helped me and did all that for us, me and Jimmy. It's a different life, different through people caring. And these people deserve help to help other people. Because I'm only one, I mean, there must be thousands out there. And that worries me, because I think, shoot, they've been through not getting sleep, you know, no being a wreck, no caring about themselves. Because when they run out, they're saying, oh, where is he, you know, is he all right? And running back, just no worry and feeling happy. And Jimmy's so happy, because he's happy in here. Never wondered since I got all this equipment in, never. He's happy. I'm happy. We've got a life. It's great.
I think that tells it all. Simple technology and the difference it can make to somebody's life.